Welcome to Lesson 6 of the Men's Bible Study for Spring of 2021. We are going to be progressing in the Sermon on the Mount and tackling a section that has caused me havoc over the years. So this has been a great study for me, a great time to dive in and and look at the things that I not only was challenged with, but things that I thought I understood that I through this process got a better handle on. You know, in our pursuit of the meaning of Jesus' teaching, we have to hold on securely to the fact that he was speaking to an entirely Jewish audience. A Jewish audience which had held to their identity and doctrine for nearly 2,000 years at this point, tracing back to God's inception of the Abrahamic covenant. Process that as being more than five times the history of our country. Now, what is our consistent approach? It's observation, interpretation, and application. And of course, we want to stay within those boundaries as we approach this not only magnificent, but very lofty section of Scripture. In Matthew 5, 17 through 20, our observation and looking at the big picture of the context, we have to keep, again, clearly in mind that this is Scripture, not just a narrative or a story. God recorded what he did to change history, to intervene in the affairs of man, and to change you and I. There have been roughly 400 years of silence from God since Malachi issued the warning, "Lest I come strike the earth with a curse," Malachi 4, 6. Medo-Persia has lost its rule of Israel to Alexander, and that rule was lost to Ptolemy of Egypt, and that rule was lost to Syria and the wicked Antiochus Epiphanes. The Maccabean revolt against Syrian rule established a fragile self-rule for nearly 100 years before being forced into submission under the iron-fisted arm of Rome. Jerusalem surrendered for the last time to Herod, and Herod's slaying of Antigonus, the last Maccabean king priest, only 4 years before Jesus' birth. This is very real context for everything that's going on here as Jesus is preaching this Sermon on the Mount. Think of, from our standpoint, how relative the Gulf War, or even more so, Vietnam, is in the minds of those of us that are Americans. All of this history, the legacy of self-rule and the Maccabean revolt, is all in the background of everything that's going on in the local context and the local history at this time. The major section that we're in, and the context of that is, of course, we're very much still in the Gospels. This is the revelation of Christ and his first advent to earth. History itself was divided by this time when God chose to clothe himself in the person of man and come unto his own. See John 1. John eloquently states how God, the creator of everything, in whom only there is life, chose to humble himself and become a man that he could offer redemption to his own. This Jewish Messiah is anticipated by a very weary and worn group of Jews of all stripes. Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, Herodians, zealots, the Essenes, and the uncommitted. All had an interest in deliverance. Most were weary of war, but they also despised Rome. And most were also looking for an easy way to get God on their side outside of the detailed commitment to righteousness required by the scribes and the Pharisees. When we narrow down our view of context to just the book of Matthew, as Jesus opens his ministry, Matthew spotlights Jesus' sermon near the Sea of Galilee. And in that, Jesus making declarative statements, not requests. He, Jesus, is not asking anyone's ideas or opinions. He is declaring absolute, inviolable truth. Matthew is presenting the king to a nation and a people who are awaiting a king. He is laying out an arguable case that this is the one for whom they have waited. And Jesus makes no apology for telling the truth to those that most need to hear it. Narrowing our scope of context right to the chapter and verse, we've looked at the context as to what brought Jesus to this point. It is probable, almost certain, that this is not the only time that Jesus has given this message that he preaches on the Mount here. He is opening the minds and hearts of his listeners to the fact that what they are seeking may not be the right pursuit. But he has gotten here by a rough road. Joseph has died somewhere in the last number of years, and Jesus has been almost certainly supporting his mother and his brothers and his sisters, and may well still be. Jesus had just finished being tested in the wilderness for a painful 40 days. His relative, the dynamic and dedicated John the Baptist, fulfilling the role of Elijah, had been arrested and is soon to be killed in prison. Jesus has moved probably his whole family from Nazareth to Capernaum, a journey of a couple of days, roughly 19 miles, but a shift from about 1,400 feet above sea level to roughly 700 feet below sea level over very rough landscape. Jesus is speaking here to Jews who are desperate to regather their nation, who are looking for someone to take the law off their backs and expecting a Messiah whom will deliver them not only from their burdens, but who will make their nation the focus of the world again and put them back in the saddle as the chosen people of God. With as little obligation in this process on their part as they can wrangle. Having established our context, obviously we come to the next step in our process, which is interpretation. We've got to remember our basic rule for interpretation. There is only one original meaning of what God recorded. That's what we're looking for. One meaning, many applications. So we see here, and I think I failed to mention the pictures that you're seeing here. This is the view from what is probably the location that Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mount, down over the lake, the Sea of Galilee. A beautiful spot, something I didn't know, that historically and still today, bananas grew in that area. I had never thought of Jesus eating bananas as part of his diet, but such apparently is the case. There is so much here in Matthew 5, 17 through 20. Christ and the law. Why? What relationship does Christ have to the law? And almost as important, what relationship do we have to the law? There is really so much here, and I'm telling you that I am not in any way able, I'm not up to the job of doing this justice, but this has been so good for me to come back to. I've had to be on my knees several times as I came to the point of understanding small parts of the magnitude of what Christ is saying in this superlative sermon. I had to correct some of my own small thinking, and I hope I can convey something of the earth-shaking truth that Jesus puts on the table in this part of his message. Matthew 5, 17 through 20 is our passage, and I want to remind us that this is Christ speaking, and let that resonate in our thinking as we consider the permanency of his statement. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Matthew 5, 17 through 20. So what is Jesus saying here? A whole host of commentators and scholars have spent endless hours and years unpacking this portion of Jesus' sermon and that he gave here at the opening of his ministry. One of the most sure things we can draw from this passage is the permanence of his word and the law. But what does the latter mean? What does permanence of the law mean? Are we subject to the law? Does the law have any bearing in the church age or the church economy? How does this fit with the attributes of the blessed, which Jesus has just enumerated? Jesus is putting the law where it should be, in a holy and a reverent place. This is the disposition of God. The law speaks in its totality about the great high nature of the character of God. We simply cannot, in our fallen state, imagine the holiness of a being forever free in all eternity of any nuance of a wayward thought or action or intention. Our God is absolute in His holiness, and the law is about character and not endless lists. The complexity of man is seemingly unending, but every bit of that complexity was created to be an interleaf with the Creator that created us. The law encompasses much of that complexity and puts legs to reminding man in every task, in every moment, that he is created to love and interact with his Creator. Paul called the law a pedagogue, a schoolmaster, leading us to Christ. Not to chase, our job is not to waste our life chasing entanglement with evil and perversity. Throughout the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus challenges the earthly nature of the listeners. MacArthur notes Jesus' message was that his kingdom is eternal. That is, this is the underlying foundation of the Sermon on the Mount. Christ's kingdom did not embrace external ritualism, philosophy, geographical location, or social activism as a basis for operation. The Sermon on the Mount opens the door to the new covenant prophesied in Jeremiah 31:33, where God says, "I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts." To the religionists of his day, our Lord said, "Except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven." He meant that unless they had more going for them than the external things that they were focused on, they would not be part of his kingdom. Jesus' response to the Pharisees was that religion is not a matter of external observance. His reaction to the Sadducees was that he said religion shouldn't invent philosophies to accommodate changing times. To the Essenes, he said that religion is not a matter of geographical location. And to the Zealots, his message was that social activism is not the answer. What is the law then? The Jewish scholars, the scribes, had put a great deal of effort over the years into taking the law of God and extrapolating ordinances, which were, by statement, intended to quantify the intent of what God had said into an actionable item. For example, when God said, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy, do no work," in Exodus 20:8-10, what did God mean by work? They came up with answers. The scribes did. A lot of answers. Carrying a burden was work. But what was a burden? A burden became codified under scribal law as food equal to the weight of a dried fig, enough wine for mixing in a goblet, milk enough for one swallow, honey enough to put on a wound, oil enough to anoint a small member, water enough to moisten an eye salve, paper enough to write a customs house notice, ink enough to write two letters of the alphabet, reed enough to make a pen, and on and on. Was this what Jesus had come to uphold? Jesus' use of the word law seems to be pretty encompassing. I have to be careful to not create simplistic references or thoughts in my head when I just refer to the law. There is certainly a caution that has to be used in using too broad a brush in identifying law as part of the Old Testament economy. There is more to it than that. Scholars and commentators would point out four uses or four designations of the term law in the Jewish mindset at this time. One, the law can refer to just the Ten Commandments. Two, the law can reference the Pentateuch, the five books of Moses. Three, the law can reference the whole of the Old Testament. Or four, most common at this time, it references the oral and scribal traditions that a collection of rabbis and scribes had been coming up with for several hundred years at this point that defined what the rules were, those actionable items, what was supposed to be the interpretation of God, what God meant in a viable way to translate that into shoe leather. Jesus' use of the term here in our section of Matthew 5:17-20, the law and the prophets, undoubtedly refers to the whole of the Old Testament. Every time we see this reference in the New Testament, this is what it means. Jesus was not coming to fill up the traditions of men. He flatly puts these down in chapter 15, but he is coming to fill every bit, all of the Old Testament. Not everything is done yet. There are things yet to be fulfilled, but every last bit of it is fulfilled in Jesus Christ. MacArthur's comments are great here again, and MacArthur has such scholarship in this area. I've referred to him several times, but others have done great work as well. But he says, and so Jesus is saying, look, I know what you're thinking. I know you're thinking I'm going to set this law aside. I'm not. I'm going to lift it up higher than it is today. And I'm going to reveal the hypocrites. You're thinking I'm going to put it all away, and we're not going to have to deal with any of this hassle anymore. And we can just be free and easy and do what we want. And it'll all be wonderful. I'm telling you, God's standard hasn't changed. No part of the sacred scripture will ever be destroyed or annulled. It will be fulfilled, and I myself will fulfill it. Listen to this. The Old Testament is about Jesus Christ. In Genesis, he is the seed of the woman. In Exodus, he is the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he is the high priest. In Numbers, he is the pillar of cloud by day and the pillar of fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he is the prophet like unto Moses. In Joshua, he is the captain of our salvation. In Judges, he is the judge and lawgiver. In Ruth, he is the kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is the trusted prophet. In Kings and Chronicles, he is the reigning king. In Ezra, he is the faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he is the builder of the broken wall. In Esther, he is the Mordecai. In Job, he is the ever-living redeemer. In Psalms, he is the Lord, our shepherd. In Proverbs and Ecclesiastes, he is true wisdom. In the Song of Solomon, he is the real lover and bridegroom. In Isaiah, he is the Prince of Peace. In Jeremiah and Lamentations, he is the weeping prophet. In Ezekiel, he is the wonderful four-faced man. And in Daniel, he is the fourth man in the fiery furnace. In Hosea, he is the eternal husband, forever married to the backslider. In Joel, he is the baptizer with the Holy Spirit. In Amos, he is the burden bearer. In Obadiah, he is the Savior. In Jonah, he is the great foreign missionary. In Micah, he's the messenger with beautiful feet. In Nahum, he is the avenger. In Habakkuk, he is God's evangelist pleading for revival. In Zephaniah, he is the Lord, mighty to save. In Haggai, he is the restorer of the lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is the fountain opened in the house of David for sin and for cleansing. In Malachi, he's the Son of Righteousness arising with healing in his wings. He is the theme of the entirety of the Old Testament, and every bit of it is his story. The law then can really be looked at as tripartite, or composed of three parts: the moral law, the ceremonial law, and the judicial law. Jesus came to fulfill all of it. He is the fulfillment of every portion of the law. The judicial and ceremonial laws were set up for Israel as a nation, for God to deal with them specifically as a nation. The judicial portion of the law is really sourced in the moral law, and there are other fingers that go back and forth a bit, but these portions of the law were intended to set Israel apart. The judicial law was set aside when Israel as a people rejected their king, and the ceremonial law was set aside when the final sacrifice was made upon the cross, and the veil of the Holy of Holies was rent in two from the top to the bottom. God is not dealing with his chosen people as a nation at this time today. And Paul makes this very clear in Romans and Ephesians that being a Jew or Gentile are all the same in the church. Jesus will fulfill every element of the promises to his people at some time in the future when God does again deal with his people, his chosen people, the Jews, as a nation. But this leaves us the moral law of the three parts of the law. Does God change, is the question. Does his character adjust to the times or the circumstances? Is he something one year, or something one decade, or something one millennia, and then become something else when that changes, when there's a different people populating the earth, when a generation passes? Never is the answer. For truly I say unto you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. To enter the kingdom, righteousness must exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees. How is that possible? These people ordered every nuance of their lives and were structured and disciplined. They counted mustard seeds, for crying out loud. They had the system mastered. But Jesus is the way. Only through the Messiah does one gain entrance to the kingdom. Effort does not gain one moment. Effort does not gain anyone entrance to the kingdom. Most of the epistle to the Hebrews deals with this very topic. We have so much better in the fulfillment than we did in the picture. Once in the kingdom, the law matters greatly. The moral law, the declared character of God, what he holds important, we are to imitate. So lastly, we come from observation to interpretation to application. So what do we do with this? What in my heart and life is Jesus directly laying a finger on? You know, I'll share what I've come to and just maybe some of you will be able to relate. First, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Jesus didn't do a work in my life for me to do what I want. It is not for my freedom to indulge myself that he set me free. It is for him. It is for his purposes. It is for his calling. He put me in the time and place and space and here when he did so that I could do what he has me here to do. Not for me to think that I can set aside any moral obligations to God to live how I want. God's moral law is eternal. I am obligated to keep the holy things holy and to reverence God in how I live. It is his life, not mine. I have no claim to my righteousness, let alone my life. I have no obligation higher than that which I have to my Creator and Redeemer. Second, any idea I might have that God winks at us in the church age, in this economy of God's magnificent grace, and says, yep, you're mine, but the law, that's Old Testament stuff. You can do whatever you want, and I'm okay with it, is destroyed by what Christ is saying here. Any idea like that is somewhere lower on the spectrum of viability than moon cheese. Jesus did not set aside the moral law. He fulfilled and thereby established it as the permanent standard of God for those in his kingdom, those who are God's, into eternity. This has weight, for truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. Third, it is far too easy for me to coast in this life. I have a message, actually a very positive one, about death, destruction, derailment, and distraction. Obviously positive. Years ago, much closer to the time of the Earth's creation, we used to talk about processor cycles. Every cycle we could save was precious. Efficiency was everything. You made the effort to make sure your code was tight and clean to ensure that you were not burning processor cycles with the end goal of getting every ounce of production out of that machine that you spent outrageous sums of money to purchase. My message talks about the narrowing of Satan's goal in the life of any given person. If he cannot eternally separate you from the Father by convincing you to reject Jesus Christ, he will try to convince you to destroy your life or derail it, but he always falls back to distraction. Can he get us to burn processor cycles until the useful life on the planet is gone? I hate regrets. I don't want to regret one more minute of wasted time doing things that don't line up with my goal to serve Christ. Sometimes he will certainly assign me busy work, I'm sure. But his work, his life, always has a purpose. He spent an outrageous sum to purchase my soul and yours. I don't want to fritter that away. So fourth and last, Jesus never stopped urging, never stopped cajoling, shepherding, goading, and reprimanding his hearers to hear him. There is always that one heart and ear upon which the Spirit is working that needs to hear that there is no other way but Christ. There is no other way to enter heaven, to enter here the kingdom of God, but through faith in Jesus Christ. To these hearers of Christ's sermon on the Mount, he said, "Unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is somewhat lost on us because we don't have visual witness to the incredible effort that these people went to look righteous, holy, and pious. But this means that we, as they, must meet every demand of the moral law to be as righteous as the character of God that law points to. How is this possible? There is no method or plan or even religious activity that will get any one of us there. No matter how good we look on the outside or how much we give or how nice we treat others or how mild-mannered we are, it will never be enough. Romans 8:4 states, through Christ, the righteousness of the law is fulfilled in us. Ephesians 2:8 and 9 and following tell us that it can only be a gift based on faith in the person and work of Jesus Christ. Nothing less and nothing more. If you're depending upon anything other than the person and work of Christ to broker your relationship with God, today would be an excellent day to exchange that broken religion or that method for the only one that works, and that's faith and surrender to the Messiah, Christ Jesus. We are called, brothers, to live as salt and light, to imitate His high and holy character once we are His. May God grant us all the grace to leave every ounce of effort and energy on the field of this life as He grants us the ability to do so. Godspeed.